Lung cancer is common and deadly. Smoking is the commonest cause, and all too often the tumour is diagnosed too late. Too late meaning that surgery, the only curative treatment, isn't possible. One way of getting an earlier diagnosis is to do regular CT scans on heavy smokers, but that's controversial since the scans show up lumps which require costly interventions but which may never have turned into cancer. Another way is to help people with a history of heavy smoking to recognise the symptoms of cancer and come forward to their GP. That's what John Emery and his colleagues have tried to do. John Emery is Professor of Primary Care Cancer Research at the University of Melbourne. Welcome back to the Health Report, John.
Thanks for having me again.
So, John, one of the problems here is stigma, is it not?
Indeed. So stigma is relevant at the point when patients present with symptoms. They often feel stigmatized, and that's part of the reason for why patients have often had symptoms for many months before they actually go and talk to a doctor about them.
The stigma being that they fear they're going to be hauled over the coals for being a smoker and you deserve this sort of story.
That's right. So that's certainly one of the experiences of people who are either heavy smokers or past smokers who we know are at increased risk of lung cancer. They often feel that they're lectured when they go to talk to their doctor about new symptoms, and that is part of the problem for later presentation to healthcare.
Your approach here is, can you detect it early and get people coming forward if they know they've got symptoms earlier?
That's right. So this was a targeted symptom awareness behavioural intervention in people who we knew are at higher risk of lung cancer. So similar to the sort of people who've been in the lung cancer screening trials.
But so, this was an, so heavy smokers, smoking 20 or more a day.
These were people who had at least 20 pack years and were aged over 55.
And what did you actually do?
Raise awareness of symptoms and the personal relevance of symptoms, and to emphasise the importance of early detection of respiratory disease.
And you and others have shown that GPs and others tend to get focused on blood in the sputum as being the cardinal sign of lung cancer, but in fact there are other symptoms as well which a lot of people don't recognise.
That's right. Only about 20% of patients with lung cancer actually present with blood in the sputum, and often it's more subtle combinations of symptoms such as an increase in their cough or shortness of breath and an associated weight loss. And so that's what we were trying to raise awareness amongst these patients who were near at higher risk, prompt them to monitor their symptoms on a monthly basis, and then make an appointment to see their GP if they notice changes in their symptoms. We really wanted to see whether we could impact this particular part of the diagnostic interval, which is around patients presenting to their GP with symptoms suggested of lung cancer, which we know is a major contributor to the overall time to diagnosis.
What did you find?
We found that those who received this behavioural intervention, there was a 40% relative increase in consultations specific around their respiratory symptoms.
So they weren't just turning up with the flu and saying, oh, by the way, doc, I've got increased breathlessness and more sputum.
No, that's right. This is a very specific effect.
And what about the lag period when you talk about people waiting, for example, an outpatient appointment? It's usually measured from the point where the GP puts in a request to the hospital to see the specialist. But they might have been sitting on the symptom for a year before that. Did you shorten the time that they had the symptom before they went to see the doctor?
There was a non-significant reduction of 14 days from first symptom to first presentation.
So that's not much. It's
not huge.
And whereas an increased rate of diagnosis?
This was a trial of 551 patients in primary care, and over a 12-month period, there were only three people who were diagnosed with lung cancer, two in the intervention arm and one in the control group.
So it was too small a number to know the answer to that. How long had they had the symptoms on average before they went to see the GP?
On average, it was about 70 days. So we know that patients have these symptoms for quite a long time before they actually decide to see a doctor about them.
So in summary, you know that if you teach people about the importance of symptoms in lung cancer, particularly about breathlessness, change in cough, change in symptoms, weight loss, then they will go and see the doctor. Have you got any ideas of how to shorten the time between the symptoms starting and them going to see the doctor?
That's one of the unanswered questions. So did we need to be prompting them more often to monitor their symptoms? Did we need to emphasise that part of the intervention more? I think the point is that we know that patients often have multiple visits to their GP before they're referred on for a subsequent diagnosis of lung cancer. So even just increasing the number of consultations might ultimately lead to earlier investigation and an overall reduction in time to diagnosis.
So do you think there's a case for CAT scanning screening of heavy smokers in Australia?
Oh, well, that's the big question. The health economic analysis suggests that from an Australian perspective, it wouldn't currently be considered cost effective. There's the results of the Nelson trial that are still awaiting to be published, and that may lead to a sort of further review of the evidence and whether or not it's a cost-effective strategy for a small proportion of the population who we know are at higher risk of lung cancer. This chest intervention might be an option for those people who wouldn't necessarily meet the risk threshold for CT screening, but for which earlier detection is still an important aim. And while, of course, there are still important approaches to try and support such people to make attempts to quit, we shouldn't be treating them with such stigma that they don't consult when they need to.
John, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Norman.
It's important to know that if you've been a heavy smoker and quit, the risk of lung cancer remains high for some years, so never ignore those symptoms. And as smoking becomes less common, non-smoking related lung cancer is becoming more prominent. So it's fair to say no one should ignore new respiratory symptoms. John Emery is Professor of Primary Care Cancer Research at the University of Melbourne.